All right. Welcome to CS4510. The topic of today is the Church-Turing thesis. There's five important ideas in the course. There's only five things you need to know. Everything else is filler towards those five ideas. Non-determinism, syntactic structures. The Church-Turing thesis is going to be the third one. We'll do two other topics. Incompleteness and undecidability and the relativization barrier. Church-Turing thesis is probably my favorite of the five topics. It's the best topic. And this is part of this talk is what I gave as my faculty interview as well. So what is the Church-Turing thesis? First off, what is a Turing machine? A Turing machine is, there we go. Yeah, a Turing machine is, this is a definition of a Turing machine. You have finitely many states. You have a finite set of states. You have some finite tape alphabet, perhaps 0, 1 in a blank. And then you have something like a transition function that looks like this. You have Q, sigma, Q, and Q, Q and gamma, and Q, you read a state, you write a, you add a state, you read a symbol off the tape, you transition to a new state, you write a symbol, and you choose to move left to right. So here's our little tape head paperclip. It can move left and right over this unbounded memory structure. There is a designated start state, Q0, and that's just where the computation has to begin somewhere. And then we have QH is the instruction to stop. It's listed as a state, but really you can think of it as an instruction. You enter this state, you can't ever leave it. It's the computer powers off. It somehow it figures out how to unplug itself. And then that's what computation finishes as. Shield your eyes. This is what computer science used to look like before computer scientists were around. Mathematicians should not be allowed near a computer without leaving their baggage at the door. To a mathematician, there are only a few objects, like a function or a triangle or something. So in the foundation of computer science as a science, they really did a kind of a bad job. This is a lemma from Martin Davis's 1958 book that's used to prove something we can prove very trivially today. You can see it's garbage. I mean, it's totally unreadable. You don't really know what's going on. There's lots of moving parts. And in fact, it proves something extremely simple. That it's so simple, we don't even need to state what it does. This is a screenshot from Alonzo Church's first paper in computer science, where he defines the lambda calculus. He says, for a set of recursive equations consisting of with the following equations, and he lists out some very simple things. You know, this I2 takes on 1 and 2, and it outputs a 2. By the way, Alonzo Church did not believe that 0 was a number. So unfortunately, he had to use 1 for false and 2 for true. Terrible, terrible sin he had to commit here. To him, of course, a mathematician, everything's a function, so he's talking about functions. But there's a much easier way we can do this today without any of this, and we would call this something like an instruction set. So to him, he's never seen a computer in his life. He doesn't know what a computer is. To a mathematician, everything's a function. Now, these guys both accidentally hit the mark, but they were wrong for different reasons. In the fact that a computer is not a function. It's a process. It's totally mechanical. Here's some examples of some mechanical devices, some old-timey things. You and I may know what a computer is, but before those, there was other computers and so on. These are some of the earliest. This is some sort of mechanical adder. If you didn't want to add too many numbers, maybe it multiplies or something. Is a typewriter a computer? Yes, it computes the function that puts symbols on the paper. So a typewriter, in some sense, is a computer. This is a tape, some sort of telegraph device. You can see that this obviously kind of looks like a Turing machine, right? It's literally a tape head and a reader and a writer. This is some sort of mechanical device from the 1600s by Blaise Pascal. He was trying to figure out how to add, to carry bits over when you add two numbers. Not sure how it works, not sure it worked at all. But, you know, there's a motivation here of computation is not a function. A function is something that maps a domain to a codomain, but it's a mechanical process. It's a procedure. It's a sequence of steps that occurs, not instantly. It's not simply input to output mapping, but it as a function of time, it has to occur. One of the first people to realize this was Alan Turing. So here's a photo of Alan Turing when, I don't know, high school or something. And I was looking for photos in the Alan Turing archive of old-timey mechanical devices he would have found. And I found this letter that he wrote when he was like 9 years old. And I'll just read it to you. It is luck I don't have to show up my letters, or Mr. Darlington would confiscate the whole bottle, probably. This week, I thought of how I might make a typewriter like this. And then there's like a 9-year-old's drawing of what a typewriter might look like, something like a spider. I don't know. Several errors. You could see there's like a tree typewriter head in some sense. You see the funny little rounds are letters cut out on one side and slide along to the round A. And along an ink pad, and stamp down and make the letter. That's not nearly all, though. Love from Alan. So it's from the King's College Library in Cambridge. You can see here, Alan Turing, at least at this young age, is not a mathematician. He is a proto-engineering student. Everyone who's ever gone to an engineering school as a child took apart their father's microwave and failed to put it back together successfully, and they got mad at him or something like this. You know, you take apart the thing to see what's inside, and all you see is gears and wires, and failed to put it back together or not. Alan Turing was not a mathematician. He was definitely an engineer. And it's to him that we credit the invention of entire computer science. The fact that he was able to come up with a Turing machine and as a model of computation and not something functional is very unique to him. So even at 9 years old, we see this. So what is the Church-Turing thesis? An algorithm is an informal, intuitive notion of a process, a set of instructions to complete a task, a recipe to make a peanut butter jelly sandwich is an algorithm. It's a set of instructions for you to do something. Computation is doing things. A Turing machine is one automata. It's a formal model of a computation, right? It does compute things. Turing machines compute things. You and I compute things. The Church-Turing thesis asserts that the Turing machine captures the intuitive definition, that everything computable in the intuitive sense is computable by a Turing machine. But why? So the intuitive notion of algorithm is an ancient one. Okay, Euclid had an algorithm for computing the greatest common divisor. Al-Khwarizmi had a recursive multiplication algorithm, and so on. So what actually was an algorithm is kind of a intuitive and pre-scientific concept. And the Church-Turing thesis claims that the Turing machine is an exact and perfect formalization of of computation. Intuitive computation. And that's, at first, controversial because the Turing machine only has three instructions. It's got to read, write, and move. It can't do anything else. Yet, you are expected to believe that all computation, anything that you can do with pen and paper, can somehow be captured by some Turing machine to do that same process. Almost unbelievable. So let's see what certain people have to say on this topic. Here's the first description of the Church-Turing thesis from Mike Sipser's book. This is the book, official book for our class. Informally speaking, an algorithm is a collection of simple instructions for carrying out some task. Commonplace in everyday life, algorithms sometimes are called procedures or recipes. Even though algorithms have had a long history in mathematics, the notion of algorithm itself was not defined precisely until the 20th century. Before that, mathematicians had an intuitive notion of what algorithms were and relied upon that notion when using and describing them. But that intuitive notion was insufficient for gaining a deeper understanding of algorithms. The definition came in the 1936 papers of Alonzo Church and Alan Turing. Church used a notational system called the lambda calculus to define algorithms. Turing did it with his machines. These two definitions were shown to be equivalent. This connection between the informal notion of an algorithm and the precise definition has come to be called the Church-Turing thesis. Right? There's a bug in this state, in these paragraphs. What is the issue? I would personally take error with something that is said here. Although it's not obvious and subtle what it is. Any guesses? I'll tell you. The paragraph asserts that the two definitions were equivalent. The definition of a lambda calculi and the definition of a Turing machine are equivalent in power. The same way we saw a context-free grammar and a PDA are equivalent in power. The lambda calculi and a Turing machine are equivalent. But the sentence says this connection between the informal notion of algorithm and the precise definition. That's not what is asserted here. It's asserted not the equivalence, it asserts that the equivalence of lambda calculi with Turing machines is the same thing as the equivalence of the informal notion of algorithm, the pre-scientific concept, with the Turing machine. Those are distinctly different, unless you already believe that the lambda calculi was equivalent to thought, which is huge and egregious, actually. So this I would consider be a bug in this. So let's go to a different book. Let's see what they say about this. Interestingly, all the serious proposals for a model of computation have the same power. That is, they compute the same functions or recognize the same languages. The unprovable assumption that any general way to compute will allow us to compute only the partial recursive functions or equivalently, what Turing machines or modern-day computers can compute is known as Church's hypothesis, after the logician A. Church, or the Church-Turing thesis. So this book, Hopcroft, Motwani, and Ullman, says that the Church-Turing thesis is basically that the Turing machine is as powerful as a modern-day computer. It's not saying that it's as powerful as you, a person. The informal notion of algorithm has been captured by a Turing machine. Let's look at another book. This is Martin Davis's 1958 text. It at least addresses the question that we would like to answer. The situation is quite analogous to that met when whenever one attempts to replace a vague concept having a powerful intuitive appeal with an exact mathematical substitute. An obvious example is the area under a curve. In such a case, it is, of course, pointless to demand a mathematical proof of the equivalence of the two concepts. The very vagueness of the intuitive concept precludes this. So you can't prove mathematically that a Turing machine is equivalent in the computational ability of a human, because the computational ability of a human does not exist in a formal system. He says that. But still, I don't see a justification about why these two should be equivalent. Humans are very capable in what they can do, but Turing machines, at least on the definition, appear to be quite limited. If we were to represent, here's a fourth definition. This is from Lewis and Papadimitriou. Turing machines can be imitated by grammars, which can be imitated by mu recursive functions, which can be imitated by Turing machines. Here by grammars, they mean a stronger model than the context-sensitive grammars we've seen. We'll talk about what's called an unrestricted grammar next time. In our notation, this is what they proved in this whole chapter for Church's thesis. They proved the Turing machines can be simulated on the unrestricted grammars, which can be simulated on these mu recursive functions, which can be simulated on Turing machines. So Turing machines on the left, Turing machines on the right, basic set theory, the whole thing collapses. Right? All these models must be equivalent. But again, we don't see an explanation about why the Turing machine is a good definition of algorithm. We know the PDA is not a good definition of algorithm because we can find a language that we can compute, WW, that the Turing machine can't. Excuse me, that the PDA can't. But why should the Turing machine be a good definition of an algorithm? Here's a picture that illustrates what I'm trying to see. Let the arrow represent one device may simulate another. Church's thesis in all these books asserts that these models are all equivalent. Any reasonable model of computation you can come up with is one that may simulate the other more powerful models of computation. So it turns out Turing machines are equivalent to this recursive function definition, which are equivalent to the lambda calculi, which are equivalent to semi-thew systems. And all these different models and automata of computation people come up with, they're all the same. But what's not addressed is how this relates to the intuitive notion of what an algorithm is. The human notion of computation, a person doing something. So I searched around for this question, and sort of that's my own personal history with this, is I was looking for an answer to this, and no book would address it directly. They just sort of would do a trick of the light and say, well, these are equivalent, so it must be to the human. And the question was not really addressed. But I went to the source, and I should have done this much earlier on, and that's where the answer lies. In the original paper by Alan Turing, here he is at like 21. He's sitting in Princeton, I think, and he's reading a little book. In the original paper on computable numbers with an application of the Inshai-Dunch problem, we'll talk about what that is later, but here he defines the Turing machine and he answers the question exactly what I'm looking for. He solves the problem exactly. In this paper is the birth of computer science. Everything before that was not computer science. This is the start of computer science, the invention of the Turing machine and the answer to the question that we're searching for. So here's a quote-unquote how we'll prove the Turing machine, prove the statement we want, that the Turing machine is equivalent in power to the human. We'll argue that in two parts, Turing machines are equivalent in power to the human mind. That's what we'll argue today, and we'll present Alan Turing's argument in favor of that. That's the answer to the question we want. The second point is that there is no computing device strictly more powerful than the human mind. That is sort of a postmodern thing we've had to answer about, like, can we invent a computer architecture that could do something we can't, something like that. We'll have to answer that question later. Alan Turing wasn't walking. People didn't have phones in their pockets, you know. So no one was really afraid of a computer being stronger than they were yet. You know, Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov. That was only in the 90s. So the fact that computers can do things is still kind of a new concept to us. Every day we live through a horrific scientific revolution. We'll do the first argument, first point first. But any questions before we get into that so far? Okay. So we're going to prove the two classes, LTM, which is the class of languages decidable by a Turing machine, is equivalent to the class of languages decidable by a human. Now, L-human is not a very is not relative to a formal automaton. A language is in L-human informally if you can decide it. If you with pen and paper could be like, yeah, I could do that. That's an L-human. LTM is a formal model of computation with respect to the formal definition of Turing machine. Okay, we have two classes. How do you prove two sets are equal? Double set containment, right? So we'll do double set containment. We'll prove that for every algorithm that a human can do, it can be done on a Turing machine. That's certainly going to be the harder way. The easier way is to prove that everything a Turing machine can do can be done by a human. So let's address the easier question first, that everything that a Turing machine can do can be done by a human. Why is that true?
Because you can simulate the Turing machine manually.
Yeah, you can think about it, right? I gave you a DFA. You could do that with the DFA, and then you did the DFA. In your brain, wires and pipes are moving. You pretended you were the DFA. The simulation exists. I gave you a description of a Turing machine. I give you a word. You can just, with pen and paper, you do your little tracing. You figure it out. You can do whatever the Turing machine does. Yes?
Does it matter that the Turing machine is infinite?
The Turing machine is not actually infinite. Usefully so, any Turing machine that halts, the good ones, can use only a finite amount of space. So there's a difference between an unbounded and arbitrary versus literal infinite. But do we agree with that? You can think about it, right? Now that is a vague vague thing on purpose, but let's sort of attempt to formalize it. It is still a vague concept. We'll call it the fathomability criterion. Let C be any computational model, decision procedure, or mechanical process. Again, vague on what C is. We said C is said to be fathomable if you can think about it. And I'll put "you can think about it" in quotes, because what can you think about is something that you know you can think about it. So if you can think about it, it's fathomable. If C is any such device which passes this fathomability criterion, we may say that L of C is a subset of L human. This is true for PDAs, DFAs, context-free grammars, everything, right? If you can think about it, it's a subset of L-human. In some sense, this makes L-human a very large class. It's unimaginably huge. Anything you can solve, pen and paper, it's in L-human. Any other automaton that you can simulate on the wires in your brain, if it passes the fathomability criterion, then it's a subset of it. So from that, we see pen and paper, you can trace the execution of a Turing machine, QED. Questions on that one? Almost too easy. Let's get to the harder direction. Yeah, let's get to the harder direction. You want to simulate a human on a Turing machine. Ridiculous concept, in fact. And that's the answer to the question we've been looking for. How would this work? Turing, in his original paper, did all these theorems and proofs and all these things, but he also gave a very rigorous philosophical justification about why his answer was a good one. Not just that he answered a question, but he was the one to answer the question. And he does this argument in chapter 9 of something called the direct appeal to intuition. We know that, you know, a human being a pre-scientific concept, you can't formally prove it. You just have to give as good of an argument as you can in favor of this. So here's how the argument will follow. First, we will agree on an example of a computer. Okay? We'll agree on what is a thing that performs computation. Then we will distill and simplify the example down until it's as simple as possible. The distillation makes it simple to formalize. We make very small changes, agreeing that these small changes don't actually change the thing computing. And then we are left we must agree then the composition of these changes doesn't change computation, so we're left with a very simple model of computation. So to begin with this is almost like a reduction. To begin in this way, we first need an example of a computer. What's an example of a computer?
Human.
A human. Yeah, so, right. We'll start with me. I'm an example of a computer. Undeniably so. If you were going to say a laptop, well, I'm not convinced exactly, because there may be things that I can do that a laptop can't. I'm not too sure. But perhaps an undisagreeable answer is me. We'll start with me. I can compute things with pen and paper. Any qualms? Any questions? Don't need electricity, just need oatmeal. Now, do I need bones? Are bones necessary for computation? It's not a rhetorical question. Possibly. You do need some sort of minimal life support system. Do you need lungs?
Yeah.
Okay, suppose we get all that, we just put it in a pill. You don't need bones, you don't need lungs. Do you need legs?
Yeah.
No. You don't need legs. Do you need skin? Teeth. Okay. We'll boil all the parts off, and I claim that we're left with only in exactly this. We'll call it the creature, okay? This is, in some sense, if you were to remove all the parts that I needed for that don't need for computation, including the pain receptors and all these things, and you're left with the following pieces. You have, of course, the brain. The brain, we know, is responsible for computation. It's responsible for everything. Aristotle actually thought the brain was just a giant heat sink. He thought the heart did the thinking, and he thought that the brain cooled the blood down. But now we know better, because when you mess in the brain, you poke around in there, people start slurring their words. So we know the brain is important for computation, at least. Now, here's a controversial decision. I claim I need a little bit more than the brain. I claim I need an input-output system and something external to write on. Controversial decision, but a true one. You may think, well, I can think in my head. My argument in favor of this is the fact that I can do things with pen and anything you can do in your head, I certainly can also do in my head, but then I can also do probably more with pen and paper. The pen and paper model is a more general one. So let's take the most general one. Let's take one with where I have access to read and write to some book. Okay. We're going to go through, this is me talking about 60 minutes about what's just two pages in his paper. We're going to go through paragraph by paragraph and just make sure we understand how this reduction works, illustratedly. This is his writing now, a British guy. So, computing is normally done by writing certain symbols on paper. We may suppose that this paper is divided into squares, like a child's arithmetic book. In elementary arithmetic, the two-dimensional character of the paper is sometimes used. But such a use is always avoidable, and I think that it will be agreed that the two-dimensional character of the paper is no essential of computation. I assume then that the computation is carried out on a one-dimensional paper, i.e. a tape divided into squares. His first observation, the geometry of the writing surface doesn't matter. Work can be done in a book, it can be done on loose leaf, it can be done on a sphere, it could be done on an infinite scroll. So let's simplify the model. Let's get rid of the pen and paper so we don't have to flip pages. Okay. Let's just suppose that you have a one-way infinite scroll, a literal tape, and that you can read and write to it. When you do math, you do line by line by line, but suppose you just did it in one solid line. It would be annoying, but you could still do it. We have not changed computation. And suppose this operation is a relation that says it's a simplification, but the nature of computation is invariant to the changes made, something like this, right? We have performed a simplification. We have not changed the nature of computation. I shall also suppose that the number of symbols which may be printed is finite. If we were to allow an infinity of symbols, then there would be symbols differing to an arbitrarily small extent. The effect of this restriction on the number of symbols is not very serious. Is not very serious. It is always possible to use sequences of symbols in the place of single symbols. Thus, an Arabic numeral, such as 17 or several nines, is normally treated as a single symbol. The difference from our point of view between the single and compound symbols is that the compound symbols, if they are too lengthy, cannot be observed at one glance. This is in accordance with experience. We cannot tell at a glance whether several nines and several nines are the same. Quick, are those two blocks of nines the same? Why?
Left one has one more nine.
How did you do that?
I don't know. I looked at it.
You looked at it? That's going to disprove my argument. The whole point of this is that you can't look at them instantly and tell them apart. I'm going to pretend you didn't do that fastly. In order to tell these two strings apart, you would have to go symbol by symbol, perhaps in large blocks, five nines at a time, five nines at a time, something. And that's the way you would tell them apart. Computation is done as a sequence of steps. Alan Turing has to argue here that, like, if you do things, if you need to do something bigger, you may take a sequence of steps. You can't do basically infinite work in a finite time, in some sense. A second important detail is this. This is in accordance with experience. To him, a computer was someone doing computation. It's not like a literal mechanical device. It's a person doing computation. He has in the background all these implicit assumptions about what's going on, unstated premises, and then the argument is still continuing correctly, but they're perhaps implicit about what's going on here. A third thing is this little dagger here about the symbols differing. So he has this this little footnote. If we regard a symbol as literally printed on a square, we may suppose that the square is the x and y coordinates 0 through 1, the unit square. The symbol is defined as a set of points in the square, viz. The set occupied by printer's ink. If these sets are restricted to be measurable, we can define the distance between two symbols as the cost of transforming one symbol into the other if the cost of moving the unit area of printer's ink unit distance is unity. And there is an infinite supply of ink at x equals 2, y equals 0. With this topology, the symbols form a conditionally compact space. A lot of math words there, but basically what he's saying is consider, he's asserting that the alphabet gamma is finite. Suppose that there it was infinite. What he's saying is that you would not be able to tell, there would be so many symbols you couldn't tell some of them apart, you know? Do you guys know the definition of a compact space with respect to topology? That's with a metric space. Wrong. No, so a closed and bounded, you cannot define bounded in a metric space and a topological space unless it has a metric. But that's actually great because of course you have a metric here.
Every open cover has a finite subcover.
Exactly. Every open cover in topology has a finite subcover. No one else should know that, I think. No one else has seen that in any course. Every open cover has a finite subcover. If you have infinitely many things, basically things will fall out nicely into almost equivalence classes and finitely many of them. If you have all these infinitely many symbols, they will fall into categories according to your vision, and you'll say there's only like 37 distinct letters, okay? There's 58 letters on the keyboard, okay? If you want more letters, just use sequences of letters. That's all he's saying here. Consider all the weird things you could do as well. Consider you put a dot of ink for every irrational number. What would that would be indistinct. That would be like a very, very light shade of gray. You wouldn't even be able to tell it apart from a solid white square, right? That would not be a measurable symbol, but that's basically what happens, right? Finitely many symbols. That's why for every automaton, sigma or gamma is all finite. Because you can only tell finitely many symbols apart. Finite work is done in finite time. This is going to be important for complexity later. And that the number of symbols necessary for computation is finite. So he says, well, sigma is not infinite. We're basically going to arrive at the definition of a Turing machine. The behavior of the computer at any moment is determined by the symbols which he is observing and his quote-unquote state of mind. This is the etymological root of the term state in computer science, by the way. It comes from Alan Turing saying a state as a state of mind. That's why we don't call them nodes or vertices. We call them states. It's a literal mind. It's a piece of memory, your brain cell, observed in a state of mind at that moment. We may suppose that there's a bound B to the number of symbols or squares which the computer can observe in one moment. If he wishes to observe more, he must use successive operations. So if you want to read more than the thing you're currently staring at, you have to move. It takes time, it takes energy, it takes a step. The new observed squares must be immediately recognizable by the computer. I think it is reasonable to suppose that it can only be squares whose distance from the closest of the immediately previously observed squares does not exceed a certain fixed amount. Let's say that each of the new observed squares is within L squares of an immediately previously observed square. What he's saying is two things. One, you can only read finitely many squares at once. You can't read the whole page in like that. You can read five letters at a time, whatever. One word at a time. 10 words at a time. Who cares? But there's still a bound to the number of symbols you can read at once. He also says when you finish reading something, you want to move to read something else. You cannot move to the end of the article immediately. You have to move no more than a distance L from what you're looking at. And if we take our definition of the Turing machine here, we just have L equals B equals 1. You read one symbol, and then you can move one symbol, at most one symbol. That's what he's saying. We'll simplify L and B and just say it's 1. Also, he also asserts gamma only takes as input the current state of mind and the current symbol read. So here, in those paragraphs, he basically asserts the correctness of the transition function's domain. It's gamma, what you're reading, and where you are. What you're thinking and what you're reading. That's the transition function's domain. Later, the dot, dot, dot will explain the codomain. Why the transition function should look like that. So here we performed a simplification. We started with our guy, and we remember we took away his book, we gave him a scroll, and now we have taken away his input and output system, and we've replaced it with a humble paperclip. He doesn't need to read 10 squares at once. Well, you can read one square at once. Maybe we put some magnetic fluid on the tape, and then it sends a positive signal and gives him a little dopamine, something like this, right? He can still do all the computing. In agony, but the computing can still be done, right? Perhaps even the paperclip, of course, has to have the ability to write. So it reads and writes one cell at a time. Tedious, but still, we have not changed the nature of computation itself. We will also suppose that the number of states of mind which need be taken into account is finite. The reasons for this are of the same character as those which restrict the number of symbols. If we admitted an infinity of states of mind, some of them will be arbitrarily close and confused. What he's saying here, of course, is that Q is finite. The number of states of mind is finite. Human memory, earlier in the passage, in the paper, he says human memory is necessarily limited. Your brain is a finite matter. So, of course, there are only finitely states of mind. For any algorithm, there's only finitely many states that go between those two. You know, every piece of code is only finitely many lines long. What he asserts here is the same, that the number of states is not an infinite set, it's a finite set. Q is a finite set. That's what he's asserting here. Question so far? Yes.
Doesn't your brain change, not just its state?
Great question. 40 years of history on this question. Isn't this, the Turing machine is fixed, but brains rewire themselves, right? But the conditions that, the rules that define the rewiring are themselves fixed.
I can't disagree with that.
Yeah, that's the answer for you. Even suppose we were to restrict ourselves, suppose we restrict ourselves to a fixed algorithm, right? The code doesn't change, but But even if you consider those like learning tasks and things like this, you can consider that as auxiliary data, but the algorithm itself, the code of the algorithm, still doesn't change. Let us imagine the operations performed by the computer to be split up into simple operations, which are so elementary that it's not easy to imagine them further divided. Every such operation consists of some change of the physical system consisting of the computer and its tape. We know the state of the system if we know the sequence of symbols on the tape, which of these are observed by the computer, possibly with a special order, and the state of mind of the computer. We may suppose that in a simple operation, not more than one symbol is altered. Any other changes can be split up into simple changes of this kind. The situation in regards to the squares whose symbols may be altered in this way is the same as in regard to the observed squares. Basically, you can write, because you can read finitely many squares, you can move finitely many squares, there is a bound to the number of squares you can write at once. We may therefore, without loss of generality, assume that the squares whose symbols are changed are always observed squares. The symbol that you are writing to is exactly the one underneath the tape head. You're not going to write somewhere else that you're not looking. No one has ever done math writing something over here and reading something else, right? Now, if the squares are marked only by single symbols, then there can be only a finite number of them. And we should not upset our theory by adjoining these marked squares to the observed squares. If, on the other hand, they are marked by a sequence of symbols, we cannot regard the process of recognition as just a simple process. This is a fundamental point and should be illustrated. In most mathematical papers, the equations and theorems are numbered. Normally, the numbers do not go beyond, say, 1,000. It is therefore possible to recognize a theorem at a glance by its number. But if the paper was very long, we might reach theorem something, and further on in the paper, we might find, hence applying theorem something, we have. In order to make sure which was the relevant theorem, we should have to compare the two numbers figure by figure, possibly ticking the figures off in pencil to make sure they're not being counted twice, and then forget that part. What he's saying here is that gamma need not only contain the input symbols, but may contain additional symbols used in computation. So when we did our little Turing machine, we wrote an X and then we marked it, right? When you do computation, you write over the things, right? But you don't need to find a special operation for writing over a symbol. Just write a different symbol that semantically means a previous symbol which has been marked. Here we'll represent a crossed out A by a dotted A. So what you do is you read an A and you write a dotted A. That's all that's going on here. Here, the fact that you have to check these two theorems are the same, 1557 and 1557, you go letter by letter, you check them to be the same. So here, you go letter by letter, you check them off to be the same. You mark it, you mark it, you mark it, you mark it. Here he's saying gamma can be generalized. It doesn't have to be sigma. It can just be like the next, it can have additional work symbols. The simple operations must therefore include changes of the symbol on one of the observed squares. So you write changes of the squares observed to another square within L squares on the previously observed square. So you move and write. It may be that some of these changes necessarily involve a change of state of mind. The most general single operation must therefore be taken to be one of the following. a possible change of A of symbols together with a possible change of state of mind, and a possible change B of observed squares together with a possible change of state of mind. So here he finishes. We get the codomain of the transition function. You change state of mind, go from Q to Q. You write a symbol, and then you can move left or right. You move to some new square to continue the computation. We may now construct a machine to do the work of this computer. To each state of mind, the computer corresponds an M configuration of the machine. The machine scans B squares corresponding to the B squares observed by the computer. And any move the machine can change a symbol on a scan square, or can change one of the scan squares to another square, distant not more than L squares from one of the other scan squares. The move which is done and the succeeding configuration are determined by the scan symbol in the M configuration. The machine just described do not differ very essentially from computing machines as defined in section 2. And corresponding to any machine of this type, a computing machine can be constructed to compute the same sequence. That is to say, the sequence computed by the computer. Here, he asserts, he just is sort of concluding paragraph, but he inserts something important. A word he would not have used is that the Turing machine definition is deterministic. The current state and the current symbol that you are being read uniquely determines the next state of mind, the next symbol being written, and the next position of the tape head. It's deterministic. This is a deterministic Turing machine. Finally, we get our last little hurrah. We cut out all the flesh. We replace it with our well-defined transition function and our finitely many states. And we are left simply and only with the humble Turing machine. We've performed a correct reduction of all steps to the last part, and we have a Turing machine left over. We began with this, the creature, and we simplified him, and we made him simpler, and although we performed several simplifications, we didn't change the nature of computation. So if you agree that that is a computer, you are forced to, and if you agree that is a computer, and you agree none of the changes changed computation, you must concede that the Turing machine is a computer. It is complete. So let's put this back into the notation that we used earlier, okay? These are four models of computation. We don't really know what they are. We don't really care what they are. Let us use the arrow to represent that one model of computation may be simulated on another. Why is it true that all these models of computations may be simulated on the mind?
Because we thought of them in the first place.
You could think about it. Given a by to be explicit in what I mean by the fathomability criterion, given a description of the machine and an input, you may simulate the machine on your own wires and pipes to compute what the machine was supposed to compute. You can in fact come up with definitions of machines that you may not simulate, it turns out. So not simply that do you come up with the definition of the machine, but given a description of a machine, and you may execute the machine. Not the thought of the machine, but the execution of the machine. Church's thesis, from all those books that did, I think, a less great job of explaining this than Alan Turing did, explained that all these devices may simulate each other. So they're, of course, as powerful as each other. But the missing piece we now have from Alan Turing, which was Turing's thesis, that the human mind may be simulated on a Turing machine. And by composition, we get that if Turing machines are equivalent to lambda calculi, and you can simulate a human, the intuitive notion of an algorithm on a Turing machine, then by composition of those simulations, lambda calculi are also as powerful as Turing machines and also as powerful as human computation, right? So these combined tell us that all the great models of computation that we can come up with, all the strong and reasonable models, are as strong as not only as strong as each other, but intuitively capture the definition of computation, what anything a single person can do, right? This is Turing's thesis. Questions on this so far? So Church's thesis is that any reasonable, fathomable model of computation is equivalent to a Turing machine. Turing's thesis is that the Turing machine is equivalent in power to the human mind. And then you take the Church-Turing thesis to be shared by both parts. The definition of algorithm is independent of any specific formalism. Computation is one that can be formalized to be a Turing machine, but doesn't need to be. If you had to delegate to a formalization, you could go to the Turing machine, but sometimes you don't need to. You could just say, let there be an algorithm for something. And then we know we're talking about a Turing machine within a formal system. I'll also say Alonzo Church had something like this, but it was much worse and much poorly explained. He tried to explain that anything that could be computed could be done by lambda calculi. And even if you don't know what lambda calculi are, you may have a little bit of limited knowledge of functional programming because it's now in most modern languages. His justification was actually not that good. like you read it and you're like, well, I mean, okay, I mean, I guess, you know. But Turing's argument superior, greater in every way. And by the way, Alonzo Church was like an established professor at this point at Princeton. Alan Turing was an undergrad. The guy was 21 years old, came up with all this. So recall we have sort of two parts to the Church-Turing thesis. We proved one through Alan Turing's argument. Turing machines are equivalent in power to the human mind. And part two is that there is no computing device strictly more powerful than the human mind. Now, you don't really need to think about number two if you don't want to be honest. You may suppose that you only care about things that are possible by humans and stop there. But we live in a world where there's weird and strange devices being made and people are doing things. Somebody asked me, like, is a quantum computer strictly stronger than a normal computer? And the answer is no, it's just faster. So it can do the same things that a Turing machine can do, but it's just faster at it. And you know there's like the literary categories. There's like man versus man, man versus nature, man versus society. There's like man versus God. And then there's, of course, the postmodern categories, man versus technology, some other ones. We have to deal with man versus technology today, and Alan Turing didn't because people weren't walking around with phones in their pocket. Basically, what we're trying to answer is like, how come we're trying to disprove or argue against someone coming up with some kind of new hypothetical computer architecture or something that can prove, that can provably do things that a human cannot do in some sense? That's the question we're trying to resolve with the second point. Can you come up with a computer that can solve problems that a human cannot? And in some sense, is therefore strictly more powerful than a Turing machine? Well, let's see. So this is sort of the picture we have of the world. And let's rephrase the question of the second point. LNFA is a subset of LCFG. And these are subsets of L human. And we know that L human now is defined to be equivalent to LTM. So in some sense, L human, very broad, huge class. Anything that a Turing machine can do, anything a human can do. Greatest common divisor, multiplication, factoring of numbers, square roots, whatever, anything algebraic, anything, sorting out, all of it. It's all in here, right? Anything you can think of. Every peanut butter jelly recipe is in this class. We're asking the question, is there something that's strictly more powerful than it in some sense? Do aliens exist to humble us? So let's take, in fact, the Church-Turing thesis definition, okay? If C is a fathomable computational model, then C may be simulated on a human, right? And in fact, we could replace L human here with LTM. This is a more formal statement of what the Church-Turing thesis really is. By replacing L human with LTM, you get that if C is fathomable, then C is a subset or equal to LTM, right? If we express this, the Church-Turing thesis in this way as an implication, we can take the contrapositive of it. What's the contrapositive of this implication?
The language decided by C is a strict superset of the language decidable by human, like of L human, then C is not fathomable.
Correct. Now, the negation of one being a subset of another does not imply the other is a subset of it, but because L human is such a large class, we can, of course, define it in this way. If there existed a computational model or a mechanical procedure or a computer architecture or a novel way of defining an algorithm or Rube Goldberg machine, or board game rules, or whatever, C, such that the rule that this was strictly stronger than the class L human, we may also get that to imply that C is an unfathomable. C is unfathomable, right? That's just directly the contraposition of that. What does unfathomability mean? It means given a description of the machine and given a word, you cannot finish, for some reason or another, you cannot conclude that the machine accepts or rejects a word. If you can, even if you can't frame it in the language of accepting or rejecting strings, you cannot finish the simulation for some reason, right? We have actually already experienced a computational model that is unfathomable. See if you can, guys, think of every computational model or automata we've defined so far. One of them was unfathomable. Which one was it? This is a little bit of a trick question as well. It was the DIA from homework one. Do you recall that the DIA, the languages decided by the DIA was the power set of sigma star? All languages were decided by a DIA, right? That includes all languages decidable by Turing machines. We won't know it yet, but that means it's a strict the Turing machines are a strict subset of the DIA. The DIA we would consider an unfathomable computational model because you can't read a program that is infinitely lines that takes infinitely amount of lines of code. You would never finish reading the code. So how are you expected to perform the simulation of it? Right? If I gave you a description of a DIA and I gave you a word and asked you to determine if the DIA accepted the word or not, you could never perform that simulation because you wouldn't even finish reading the code. You know? DIA would be an unfathomable model. So assume to the contrary that some C exists. Then it must be unfathomable. But then what? What's the conclusion to this proof here? The answer is unsatisfying because you can't really conclude the proof. And I want you to fill in the argument here with your own evidence in favor of this. You can't, if such a C was more powerful than you thought, it must be unfathomable. But because it's unfathomable, you can't even finish thinking about why it might be unfathomable or what the relationship that may have to what we think about, right? There's this whole theory, there's all these philosophers arguing about nonsense. It's called new mysterianism. Like, some people think that no question about like consciousness will be fully explained. There's no satisfactory explanation for some of these things. And maybe that's the same here. You know, because it's unfathomable, there's no way for you to reason or argue about its limited power or superpower because of the fact that it's unfathomable. Like, it's over for you. It's doomed. It's done. So this proof, by very nature, cannot be completed. But also, you should take evidence that you've never seen of unfathomable model C. You've never encountered or used or had any interaction with a device which you would say is strictly stronger than you in any way, but is also useful to you in some sense. So if such a C existed, maybe you don't know about it. Something like this, right? That's the best we can do for the last point. So let's talk about some applications of the Church-Turing thesis. What's the cool part about this? So there's a few applications about the Church-Turing thesis. Well-specified pseudocode can always be implemented. Have you ever noticed when someone describes an algorithm to you, you can write up the code and formalize it? There's never been an algorithm description that someone can give you that you can't write up in a formal in a programming language. That's because of the Church-Turing thesis. Somebody has an intuitive notion of an algorithm, and they gave you, and you were able to construct an equivalent formalization. That's only true because of the correspondence. That's only true because of the Church-Turing thesis. Turing machines for certain computational tasks exist if you can fathom an algorithm to perform that task. So anything you can think about doing, pen and paper, can be done by a Turing machine. Maybe a tedious and long and boring Turing machine with many states, but it exists. The universal Turing machine exists. The universal Turing machine is a Turing machine that takes on input two strings. It takes on in this brackets, we use this notation to mean the string encoding of an object, to differ it from the object itself. This is a string for the code of a Turing machine M. It is the transition table and the number of states and everything's whatever. This is the code of the machine M, and this is the input W. The universal Turing machine exists such that U of M comma W is equal to M on W. Why is that true? Why does the universal Turing machine exist? Yeah.
Because I can think of a way to make any Turing machine.
Yeah, like if I gave you, because the fact that you can think with pen and paper, if I gave you a description of a Turing machine and I gave you a word, the fact that you, with pen and paper, can determine M on W means that there exists a Turing machine to do the same task. This is different between DFAs, PDAs, and so on. I claim there does not exist a universal DFA that, given a description of a PDA and a word, it simulates the PDA. I claim there does not exist a universal DFA or anything like that. The Turing machine, basically, the way it works is it has the description of M on the tape, and then it uses the other half of its tape to simulate M's tape. And then it'll like go look up the table, and then it'll go over here, and it'll like write something, and it'll come back over here. It'll read the table again, it'll go over here, and it'll write something. And that's basically what it does. That's how the simulation occurs. But the universal Turing machine exists. Okay. Here's some more applications. Any result about the formal model, the Turing machine, any theorems, these implicate the intuitive notion. So if you can prove something to be true about Turing machines, that theorem has a translated ability into our own limits as human beings. So the non-existence of a Turing machine for certain tasks implies the existence of a problem unsolvable by humans. We were able to give languages that we were able to pump those languages. We were able to show that certain languages exist that DFAs can't do, that PDAs can't do, that grammars can't produce, and so on. If we are able to construct certain languages, define certain languages that there does not exist a Turing machine for, by this implication, we may take it that there does not exist a human notion of an algorithm to solve the same problem. So there, if we can do this, therefore there exist definable problems which cannot be determined, that cannot be decided. Any more questions? Okay, that's all I have for you. Alan Turing, father of computer science, greatest of all time, did everything cool ever. Amazing guy. They put him on the 50-pound note in Great Britain. Oh, and then he was gay. The government killed Alan Turing because he was gay. Shame. He was British too, unfortunately. All right.